Hello, everyone.
What up, peeps?
Yellow.
Welcome to episode one of our DnD game, run by the wonderfully gracious Acuff. somewhere over there. Yeah, I think I put him on the left. So who are we all? Are we going to introduce ourselves as ourselves, or are we going to be our characters?
I'm introducing myself as both. My name is Servo at twitch.tv.
I forgot that was your name.
It's my last name. It's a family name.
Runs down the twitch.tv line.
Oui.
The family business. It's a very powerful family. I don't have any jokes on that yet. I'm sorry. I forgot that was a thing.
And I am the tiefling druid, Ballin Alday, from the family lineage of Alday Airyday. We're always there, and we're always Ballin Alday.
Ballin the fourth or the fifth?
I am the sixth in my lineage.
The sixth, okay.
Yeah, oh, Hustlin' Alday was my progenitor. His progenitor was killing it all day.
Killing it all day.
Yeah. Come from a long lineage.
That needs to stop.
Who else is with us?
My name's Biff. I grew up out by the creek. The caretaker that found me had died, and the creek dried up, so I'm no longer at the creek. I have to find a new creek.
To be clear, Biff is an artificer, but like a country smart one.
Yeah, yeah.
You darn tootin'.
Darn tootin'. Darn.
So high intelligence, but not so good at reading.
I don't do the words so good, but you know, I do some stuff. I like sticks.
It's a very focused intelligence.
Yeah, like, you know,
focused on sticks. Yeah.
Like, God help them if someone needs to open up a door and they don't have some way to do it. Like, whew, I'll step in. All right. That's everybody.
No, we're still missing somebody.
I am Zarko. Sounds like charcoal with a czar.
Got it. He's a dragon, guys. He's a dragon.
He's a dragon.
But not just any dragon.
Right.
He's a dragonborn. And his lineage is
and blue eyes, white privilege.
Blue eyes, white dragon. Yeah, exactly.
Oh man. Memes galore. So excited.
Beautiful.
Hell yeah.
Okay.
All right, so this is episode one of Remnant Gamers D&D. Strap in, strap on, y'all.
All right. So, you guys have been traveling for a little bit. You've known each other for a couple of weeks, but it's not a, you know, I wouldn't say you guys are an adventuring party just yet. But you guys find that together you form a cohesive unit, and you don't want to kill each other. So it's a good pairing. You've been on a boat for a while, and they just kind of like just to see the world, just to try to, you know, search job to job. And you've been dropped off, and it's kind of a smaller town. It's a little town called Blazing Dell. It's at the foot of a large mountain. You get off the boat, and you're immediately hit by the smells of furnaces burning coal. And you get the sense that it is in fact a mining town. And you can see these smokestacks poking above. Yeah, Biff, you're right at home. Like, when you weren't the crate, these are the smells you were making at home. You see smokestacks poking above certain buildings, and you hear the distant rings of pings of hammers on metal forming into whatever is needed at the time. You've kind of dropped off the port. What are you guys doing? What's the play?
I need a drink.
I follow the dragonborn and just generally try to stay out of sight.
Okay. So the dragonborn, who you all have learned is quite the drinker, just immediately goes, "I smell booze," and just starts walking off in one direction. And as you all follow, he comes across a small tavern, a small inn and tavern called the Griffin's Nest. Looks like it can't have more than 4 or 5 rooms. Kind of run down, but so is everything in this town. It's not a very prosperous area. What are you guys doing?
Let's sit down. Wait, is there room for sitting?
We're going to the tavern?
It's 4 or 5, and I'm a pretty big guy, so...
Well, 4 or 5 rooms is in, like, the inside of things. There's going to be a bar.
Rooms.
Yeah. Okay. It's not like some giant hotel. It's like, you know, the Motel 8 off the side of the highway in, like, Birmingham.
So we might have to share rooms, then.
Probably.
Mm.
It's a fair assumption.
Biz's pretty familiar with sharing things. I got an awful lot to share with y'all.
So yeah, you guys walk into the tavern.
I walk right in.
Making an entrance, just walking in.
I just walk in. I'm following Zarkal because I know he knows where the good alcohol is at. And again, I like to kind of keep to myself for the most part, but I know who to stick with.
Biff wants to look around outside to see what else is around in this town. We just got off a boat. I want to see what's here. How do I roll in this thing?
So in the chat, you're going to roll, you're going to type slash roll, 1d20, and add your perception modifier, which I know is not right in front of you.
I have it. Hold on. Actually, no, I don't have it anymore because I closed the thing. Let's open up Biff. Let's get that pop out going way off the screen so no one else sees all my Biffness. Don't be staring at my Biffletude, alright? Let's see. What am I rolling again? What am I modifying?
Perception. So you're going to do 1d20, perception. And then for this, you're going to do a -1 because you don't have good wisdom. 18, that's pretty good. So it's a 17. Just for the future, after the d20, you can put your modifier, plus whatever, minus whatever. But that's fine for now. So 17, yeah, that's really good. You look around, and you notice that a lot of these are just kind of houses of people. You know, they're like little townhomes that have, looks like they're apartments at each level, you know, at max 3 stories tall. Not super affluent, you know, most of them made of wood. Pretty run down, but not run down because they're abandoned, run down just from age. You notice a small, looks like a general store. It has you can't quite make out the name, but it has a sign swinging with a shirt and a sack, which you know is generally a sign of a general good store.
I love the good shirt sack store.
You notice a small temple, which you don't see any particular deities emblem on it, which strikes you as a little odd. But apart from that, those are the only two, and of course the Griffin's Nest, which you're standing in front of. But apart from that, there's the only two locations in town.
Now, Biff likes a good drink and all, but I think I want to wander into that store, see if they got any sea turtles for me.
Dope. Okay. All right, so we're going to go back to the tavern for right now. We'll come back to Biff. So, tavern. Servo, Zarkul, Moose, or... I'm sorry, not Moose. Ballin, are you following into the tavern? Or?
I'm making my way to the bar.
Okay.
I'm going to grab myself something to drink and probably ask around.
So you three walk in and plop down. There's a half-elf at the bar, kind of just sitting there, cleaning the glass. She looks over and goes, "Gentlemen, what do you have to drink?" She motions at the three of you.
Have a glass of wine.
All right. You too?
Do you have any hard moose wine?
You know, I can't say that I do, but I'll take a look in the back and see what I can find.
Beautiful.
And you, big fella. That's you, Latwan. Dragon ale. Okay. All right. So she kind of reaches down and she pulls out two bottles of wine. She goes, it says stag on it. That's like a moose, right? It'll do. And she plops two bottles in front of the table. She reaches under for a small, it's like a keg, but tiny. A small keg. She taps it, pours into a mug, slides dragon ale down. Zarkle. And then she pops the two bottles of wine and pours into glasses and passes. That'll be 2 copper. She puts that in hand.
Yeah, I pay.
Okay. Just pay. Thank you, kindly. Let me know if you need any help. And she goes, she wanders off to talk to some more patrons and take care of some more drinks.
2 copper. That was pretty inexpensive. How fast can I drink these?
It's a mining town.
There'd be a constitution check to do that. And copper's not super. I mean, it's inexpensive, but it's not unheard of. You're not at a college bar. It's not going to be $9 a shot. I mean, yeah. So, let's switch back to Biff. Biff, you start to walk towards the general store, and you see an old crotchety gentleman in, like, what would be nice robes if they weren't so tattered. Like, at one point, they were very nice. But they've clearly seen better days, and he's an old gentleman, so he's probably had these clothes for a couple of decades. He hobbles by, and you see in his hand he's got a clutched piece of paper, and he whispers to himself, but just not quite enough quiet so that nobody else hears him. He goes, maybe they'll listen this time. He busts open the doors of the tavern and walks in.
As I'm on the way to the store?
Yeah, it's like as you start to take steps, this gentleman like kind of brushes past.
You know, he seems to have some very fine crickware there. I wonder where he got that from. I'm gonna peek my head back into the bar real fast just to see what might be going on.
Yeah. So the three of you who are in the bar, you hear a boom. And you see a light come in from the doorway. And you hear throughout the bar a collective sigh of just, aww. And everybody, you notice everybody who's at the bar, and just from a quick scan around the room, they're kind of hiding their gaze, like not looking at the door. Just like, you know, trying to keep eye contact away from the gentleman who just walked in. And yeah, you guys see a gentleman and an older gentleman in some tattered looking, like fancy robes, but very dirty, very tattered. And he scans the room for about a minute. Is anybody making eye contact with him?
I'm looking at him in the face.
Cool. So he sees you two and goes, and kind of hobbles over slowly. He's got a little cane he's walking with, and goes, well, hello, gentlemen. You seem of quite important state. Can I interest you in a quest? And his eyes light up, and he holds up his paper. And as he says that, the bartender walks back over. Damn it, Miles. Not again. How many times do I have to tell you to stop bothering my patrons? And he says back, he goes, Miles says, but they can do it this time. They might survive. And he looks back at you and goes, don't listen to her. She's a busybody who just wants to keep people drinking. I have some real gold here. Would you boys be interested?
I want to know. Oh, go ahead.
Tell us more.
So he rolls out.
Oh, ten.
He rolls out a small sheet of paper in front of you. Turns out it's a map. There it goes. Sorry, I'm trying to track with the stream. Jono, you might want to zoom out a little bit.
Yep, I do need to zoom out some.
He rolls out a small map. He goes, this is the Stone's Tooth. No doubt you've seen its illustrious peak peeking above. the glorious skyline of Blaisdell. And you guys see off in the bottom left-hand corner a small scribble saying Blaisdell and a small arrow going off of the map. But you notice that it's a large solitary peak that kind of looks, you know, from top down, kind of seems like the same peak that was peeking up above the tops of the buildings that you can see off in the distance.
Deep inside, there's an old dwarven forge that hides much treasure. If you boys have a minute, we can sit over at my special table and I could tell you the tale.
Out of curiosity, you said that we might be the ones to survive this.
Oh!
Many of us were before us on this?
Survive is such a frivolous term. I simply mean you will be the ones to come back and reap the reward. I can only assume the others went off and found the riches and decided not to share them with you. That's the only thing I can assume. Roll an insight check.
All of us? Or just...
Anybody who wants to like see what this guy is...
I'm still just peeking my head through the door right now, right? I'm just
what's you can hear. You can hear little bits and pieces, and you can, as you're looking through the door, you see that everybody is just not paying, like, deliberately not paying attention to this gentleman at the bar. They're like, it's an avoidance. You're not sure if it's shame or if they're like, it's a shunning scenario or if they're just, they don't like it.
Now, has anybody else tried to come into the bar since I'm just kind of poking my head in? Or am I in the way? No. Okay.
Not yet. Yeah, you're just kind of standing there. Sorry, I need to pull back the chat.
Rolled a 17 on that insight.
17. Yeah, he's lying through his teeth. Yeah. He's clearly sent people on this before. But he does have a, you can tell by his tone and his excitement, he does believe there's treasure hidden there that people have not discovered. You get the sense that that's true, but the bits about him sending people off and not coming back, total lie.
I'm interested to learn a little bit more about this quest.
Yes, yes, fantastic. What are you boys drinking?
He motions over and goes, Cyril, let's go ahead and take a round to my table in the back. And Cyril the bartender goes, Miles, you don't have a table. Just pick one. You've never had a special table. I don't know why I even put up with this. Fine. I guess your coin's as good as anybody else's.
Fantastic!
And he throws a handful of coins on the table. It doesn't look like he actually paid attention to what he threw down. You guys see some gold and silver scatter across the bar and onto the floor. And he walks off to an empty table. He plops down and goes, Boys, right here. Special table. Special table right here.
I take what's left of my three dragon ales and I stop over to his table.
Okay. I'm assuming you two follow as well?
Yes.
Get the most out of my
Biff. Reluctantly.
That way.
Biff, right about now, someone goes behind you. May I partake
any
refreshments?
Certainly, sir. I move out of the way and then let him in. And can I just shout towards them to just not forget that I'm there and I'm running to the store real fast?
Sure.
Listen, I need my sea turtles, all right?
If I don't think they have those, but...
You don't know what they have at the shirt sack.
We'll see you when you get back.
I need to go to the shirt sack right now. You guys hang out, ask that old man where he got his crick clothes, okay? I would like to know where his tailor is.
Maybe if you came and sat with us, you could ask him your damn self.
I can go check on the sea turtles for you.
Miles reached to me. Oh, is this a friend of yours?
You could say that.
Yes, sir. Come in. I'll buy you a round. Come on in.
Well, you know, I was raised at the creek to never turn down the elderly. So, I'll have a drink, sir.
I'll have you know I'm much more spry than
I'm sure you are. The ladies must love you, but...
Cyril, another dragon ale for the gentleman.
And she just, all right, fine. I guess this is all right. And, like, just facing her hands. And you see her reach down and start to prepare drinks. So he rolls out this map in front of y'all, and he starts to describe a little tale.
2 centuries ago, the great dwarf smith Durgadin the Black and his clan were driven from the Stone Tooth by a horde of fierce orcs and trolls. These orcs plundered the ancestral home, slew all they could catch. Fleeing his enemies, Durgadin led the destitute remnants of his clan in search of a new home. After years of wandering, they came across our illustrious foothill. About a century ago, the orcs found this little safe haven, I guess you could say. They found the safe haven of these dwarves they've been chasing so long, and they pillaged it and killed all within. And since then, the entrance has seemingly disappeared in mystery. Although I have a lead. I'm told if you hit the right stone in the right place, a secret doorway opens. You would be open to find these treasures within and, you know, potentially run into some bad guys you could kill, you know, or befriend and do with the way, I don't know. I'm not concerned with what happens. All I would like are instructions to where the secret entrance is hidden, and perhaps maps. I would pay you for your time, and I would pay good money for your information.
So you're not interested in the treasure, then?
Oh, no, I'm interested in the treasure. If you bring anything back, I'll give you a fair market price. I'm more concerned with mapping and, you know, clearing out of the dungeon within. I'm an old man. I at one point in time I could handle a sword, but that time is long past.
You just said you were spry for your age.
Okay, I'm not that spry, so sue me. Look,
no.
He reaches into his bag and puts a small stack of coins in front of you. He goes, "I'll get 20 gold if you come back with any information on the actual whereabouts, an extra 100 gold each if you can bring me back a map." Would you guys know, 20 gold, it's a lot of money. I think it's actually more.
You cut out there.
All right.
Oh, I'm sorry. 20 gold is it's a good amount of money. It's probably more than any of you have on your persons right now.
Now, sir, do you...
And 100 gold when we get back?
Yeah.
The gold
with the map.
You know, the gold would all come after the fact, when you return.
Oh.
Now, you mentioned that there is a treasure. Do you happen to know what kind of treasure this may be?
You know, I do. I did have... Okay, so when I said nobody survived, there was one survivor. He unfortunately was he didn't want to accept my reward, but he didn't bring back this. And he pulls out of his sack a small chipped dagger that has a... if you look at the... Sorry, just to cut out. I'm sorry. Slash roll 1d20. That'll roll for you. Looks fine. He pulls out a small dagger and he goes, "This is a blade forged within the Stone Tooth inside the Dwarven Forge." And he puts it in front of you. And you can see from inspection that there's a small... It looks like a little mountain. It's a smith's mark. And it looks like a little mountain that seems to match the silhouette of the mountaintop that you saw coming in before.
As a dwarf, would I know anything about this? Anything about this weapon?
Roll it. What exactly are you trying to find?
I just wanted to see if there was anything familiar about it. And then you said there's also an etching of a mountain on it.
Yeah, roll a history check.
What am I rolling for history?
So anytime I ask you to roll, it's going to be a d20, and you're just going to add your modifier to it.
History is intelligence.
Okay.
I believe it's intelligence based, yeah.
Do I add plus 3 or just 3 after?
It'll be plus 3. So 1d20 plus 3.
All right, I rolled a 7.
Yeah. You know, you've heard stories of the Great Forge in your past. Given that it was more of like a tall tale that parents told their kids to scare them away from exploring dungeons, you know, tales of these orcs slaughtering all the dwarves within, you know. It was kind of, it seemed like it was, in your older age, you realize it kind of is like more to ward off kids from exploring places they weren't supposed to be. But every time someone told you the story, there was a little tidbit about some treasures within. You know, it could be fantasy, you know, it could just be fantasy, but it does seem to put that, you know, a cautionary tale to mark a measure of treasure when it really trying to dissuade you from going in places.
Okay. I heard tales about this out on the creek. They used to tell this to us around the campfire back when we was little cricklings. I like this old man. Now, about that dagger, do you think that I could use it on the quest? And perhaps I can attach it to a stick.
The dagger he pulled out, it's just a hilt and a very small, cracked, chipped blade. It would not be useful as a weapon. He's holding onto it clearly just for that smith's mark. It seems to be the only thing of note.
Do you think I could still attach it to a stick?
It would functionally still be a stick. He goes, I'll tell you what. You come back with information, the dagger's all yours.
You got a deal, old man.
He goes, he hands you the map and says, okay, so somewhere around here, and he just circles the entire top of the mountain where you guys can see where it turns into the forest and turns into the rocky peak. He goes, somewhere around here is the entrance. And judging from the scale, that's not a small area to travel. He goes, I am told there might be an entrance near the creek, and he points his hand down here. Points his hand down here. He goes, somewhere near the edge of the creek bed.
There's
Are you guys
creek?
Seeing that circle? Yeah. There is a creek. And he kind of cringes when he says that. He's like, creek. It's a creek. Creek. It's a small river.
Biff.
A small body of water.
Biff, this is your specialty. You've come from a creek.
I know my way around a creek.
Somewhere around there should be... It's where this gentleman brought the dagger back. He couldn't give me any specifics. He was clearly in a rush to get out of town, but that's where he said he got out of.
Ah, this was the Crick Dwarves. I got it.
How have you survived this long?
He says,
I like this old man. He promises riches at Biff's Creek. I think we should journey to this creek.
Now, old man, when we get back, if we succeed, do you think we can name this Biff's Creek? Do you think they would be so gracious enough to name this creek after me?
Unfortunately, I don't name things. I'm sure with the right amount of gold, you could convince any map maker to call it whatever you want.
Biff, he's not in the naming business. He's in the getting maps made of treasure areas business.
No, he points the servo and goes, that guy gets it.
But if he knows and he's in the business of getting maps, that means he must know who can name my crick.
You know, I do have a cartographer in town. I'm sure he could be a little helpful for the right amount, the right price.
Wonderful.
Good. Now, before we leave, I'm going to have to get the name of your tailor, too. I like your crick clothes.
Oh, my tailor! Go see Tom. He owns the general store. He has a fine selection of clothes just like this. And he kind of, he does this and some dirt falls off onto the table in front.
Ah, the shirt sack.
The shirt sack.
I was just heading there.
Kind of looks over you guys. He goes, what? He knows how to read, right? There's a big sign in front of it.
Don't pay any attention to him.
Fair enough. So gentlemen, 20 gold apiece to bring back information on the entrance. 100 gold if you bring back map. How's that sound?
One question. If you have all this information, why don't you just go do it yourself?
Like I said, you know, in my younger days, when I was a little more spry, as the large white gentleman would say, you know, it would be an easy task, but I'm in my advanced age. I'm purely, this is to satisfy curiosity and do some good for the town, you know? We need to know where those forges are. They could be immensely helpful.
Yes, interesting.
Junk strapping warriors like a servo. Can I add him on the back?
Yeah.
That so servo is a Destiny War guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, as
Mitch?
You,
is it Mitch?
It's Miles. As you pat Miles on the back, some more, like, you notice there's dust left on your hand and some more dust falls off onto the ground.
Miles Prower.
It was not Miles Prower. That's a good one. I'll keep that in mind for next time. So, if you go speak with Tom, I'm sure he can help you out with any adventuring gear you might need or some new threads for the gentleman over at the table here. I didn't get your names, by the way.
I'm Biff after the future Biff's Creek. I'm sorry, I meant Biff's Creek.
He means. He's the name that's gonna be
I understand what he's trying to say.
I'm Servo. This is you guys can introduce yourself. Dragon Man.
Sarko.
All day. Ballin. All day.
All day. I like that. Alright. Well, gentlemen, go speak to Tom. Let him know Miles sent you. I'm sure he'll give you a great deal. And he goes, this over here is where, this is where we are now in Blazendell. It's about a 3 days climb to the top of the peak. I got no more information for you, boys. But I do have gold waiting for when you come back.
Okay. It's at the top, guys.
It has been a fine pleasure, sir. Now, I do recall there was drinks.
Yeah, as you said, he goes, you know, you're right. Where are those drinks? And he takes a handful of coins and kind of shakes his hands so jingle. And Sarah just at the bar just goes, I hate this man so much. And she starts to prepare drinks and brings them over to the table and goes, here you go, Miles and Brands. And sets drinks down in front of you. She sets a large mug of some frosty ale in front of you. Biff.
Before she walks away, I go, we're not friends.
I should hope not.
I grab the mug with two hands since I'm a little dwarf, and I just chug the whole thing in one go.
Yeah. So you chug your drink. When you guys finish up your drinks, feel free to tell me what you guys want to do next. You sit there making idle chit-chat. Is there anything else you want to ask Miles? Or really anybody.
I do have one question for Miles. You had mentioned that behind these walls and things, there may be some opposition, possible friends. Are we going into somewhere that is already claimed by another?
Well, the histories tell tales of orcs that drove these dwarves out. And with all the treasure inside, I'm sure they... I don't think they would, you know, leave it behind. I imagine they probably, you know, it has been 50 years since anybody's seen orcs in these parts, but I imagine there might be orcs or something inside. I can't say for sure.
Or something. Understood.
Now,
is there anyone paying attention to us?
Make a perception check.
Is he... Do you mean right now, or do you mean, like, if we're going on this quest, is anyone going to be aware that we're going?
I think he means right now.
Yeah, this moment.
Row D20 plus.
Cool. Yeah, so with the 13, you notice that almost no one's paying attention.
Okay.
There's a couple of people that kind of glance over as Miles was talking, but it seems like there's almost a conscious effort to not. You get the vibe that they've heard the story 1,000 times, and everybody's kind of sick of it by now.
Very interesting.
Now, sir, you look like a gentleman that happens to know his way around a thing or two. Do you happen to know what kind of crick life we're looking at in this crick? Do you know if I can perhaps get myself a hold of some sea turtles?
You know, I don't think sea turtles really go in creeks very often. I know some boys like to go fish up there. I haven't heard any tales of sea turtles.
I can't tie any boys to a stick. That's just wrong.
Well, now I'm concerned.
There's nothing to concern yourself with, sir. I just need some mighty fine sea turtles so as that I can have a very fine club.
Apparently, boys tied to
it. He just kind of like, it with a slack jaw expression, just goes, ah. Well then, seems I picked the right gentleman for the job. And he kind of goes,
I'm gonna okay. Hop off my chair and walk out and go, there better be some goddamn sea turtles at that creek.
I turn to Ballin and Zarkal and I go, so Miles thinks we're idiots, by the way.
He certainly does.
We need to be very careful to, I don't know, seemingly not let Biff get killed.
A man with such disrespect for nature as to tie literally anything he comes across to a goddamn stick. Yes, I'm going to be keeping a very close eye on him.
All right, just so we're in agreement.
Fully.
I'm slamming my second dragon nail.
I smash my wine glass on the floor. No, I drink my wine and I return the cup to the bar. Because that's what I would do.
Do you say anything to Cyril?
I say, yeah, actually, I had a question. Do you know if any of this stuff that he's saying is legit?
You know, he's been saying that story for, God, 20 years now. I couldn't say for sure. I mean, he did get a dagger. I don't know where that came from. It sure didn't come from him. He didn't make it. Can't make anything.
Fair enough.
You know, he. I've never seen anybody come back with anything in that dagger, though.
You've seen people come back with him, though?
Well, I've seen him produce evidence of someone coming back, i.e. the dagger. I haven't seen any of the people he sent on this little quest of his.
Gotcha.
I haven't seen any of those come back through the tavern. I can't say why, but that's all I got for you.
You got a room for the night?
Absolutely, I do. It'll be one silver. Do you just need one room? There's only one bed, and I'm not sure all four of you can fit in that, if I'm being honest.
I put silver down immediately. This is for later. I'm going to go to the store.
I'm already walking out the door.
She slides you a key and says, first door on the left.
Perfect. I follow Biff out the door.
Nope. So yeah, as you guys walk out, you see that it's the sun's starting to set, but it's still up in the sky, so it's still light out. You see the hustle and bustle. It's, you know, there's not a ton of people. It's a small town, but it's not so small that everybody's on the same street at once. So you kind of wander through a small crowd that's gathered outside this little general store, and you see you see a small gentleman outside who's, he has something in his hands. He goes, Biff, you notice that the people standing around, just from instinct, they're a lot shorter than, like, the humans you've seen in town. They're not tall. You can't really, because you're behind him, you can't really. And you see this guy reach up to his mouth. He has a little metal tube in his hands. He goes, he blows into it, and bubbles start to pour out of it. Just kind of float away on the wind. And you see the little people go, ah! They're kids, they're children. He's entertaining them. And you see him, reach back and he dips the metal tube into a small vial. And the kids are just going.
I would like to run up to this man. Sir, may I ask you where you got your magic stick from? I really like that stick. You blow some bubbles with it, and all the kids just shout.
You never blown bubbles before?
We don't have bubbles out on the creek.
Oh my dear sir. If you come inside, I can sell you one of these magical sticks. He kind of rubs his fingers together, just like, I can sell you one of these magical sticks and all the fluid you would need. Any bubbles you could ever want.
I think this might help us very much. I start to wander inside.
So you, he kind of pats you on the back as he pushes you through the door. And it's a rather small general store, but there are bits and pieces that kind of stick out as being odd. One thing being a small shelf filled with these little metal tubes and little vials next to him. He's very, very popular with the children, but I'm sure anybody would find joy with bubbles.
Anyone with that intelligence level? I'm sorry.
He goes, "Hey, now, don't ruin a sale."
I didn't say it out loud.
Okay. By the by, unless you say it's out of character, I'm assuming it's in character speech. Just throwing that.
Oh, yeah. I'm not trying to be rude. I just thought it was funny.
Now,
you, Biff.
What kind of magic vials you got here? What can I dip this stick into? What kind of magic bayou juice we got going?
Well, that's the secret, you see. It's not actually the stick that is the magic. It's in fact the vial.
Do tell.
Have you ever heard of soap?
Why, no. We've never had soap. What is this?
He goes, I can tell. So it's a natural concoction of various oils and certain compounds that help clean things, but also create this nice little bubbly. And he grabs his vial and shakes it up. He goes, it's a nice little bubbly concoction, and bubbles scatter across and float to the ground.
Guys, I think this man is a sorcerer. We are at the right shirt sack.
I cringe.
The three of you have seen bubbles before. This is not a new thing. Like, this is clearly only new to Biff.
Yeah, I immediately cringe at the hinting that this is somehow magic.
I would like your finest magic stick. And also, there was a fine gentleman that we met at the bar. He had wonderful crick clothes. I wondered if I might be able to purchase some.
Oh, I see you've met Miles. Don't tell me he's sending you out on his magical adventure.
He said something, and I was promised that I would get a crick all to myself. I don't know what else he said.
Oh, dear.
Well, yeah, we're going to need some climbing equipment as well as whatever he wants.
Yes, of
course. Hold on. You seem to know something of this man, so... Do you know of this quest that we're already on?
Well, I've heard everyone in this town has heard the tales or 10 times.
We noticed.
Yeah. Let's just say you're not the first adventuring party to these doors.
And we won't be the last. Wait.
Speaking of not being the last... Maybe you know something of all of these people that have accepted this before us that seemingly just off and away with the goods, as he put it. So
Well, let's put it this way. I'm really the only person in town capable of paying gold, outside of Miles, of course. He's strangely made some money in the past. If people were to bring back artifacts, they would probably sell them through me. If they were to, I guess, sell them here, there's always the opportunity of trying to get one of the bigger cities to get big city gold, but the easy option for small bits and pieces, they would probably sell it through me, but I've never seen anybody come.
Interesting.
Any idea why that might be?
Well, I can only assume there's something inside that is preventing these people from coming back or scaring them off.
Just checking to see if maybe you had any idea what it would be, but...
You know, there was one... You know, a couple of weeks ago, little Jimmy came back. He was fishing up in the creek. And he looks over at Biff and goes...
The creek?
Little Jimmy said he heard some sounds coming from up the creek head, and you know, he described it, and I could only describe it as orc war, but I didn't hear it myself, so I couldn't say for sure.
So where does the dusty man get his gold from?
Interesting, yeah.
You know, that's a good question. He's been here for quite some time. You know, longer than I've been here, and I've been here for 80 years. Gentleman's an elf, it's not out of the ordinary. He says he may have come from money at some point. I couldn't be sure. He seemingly has a decent stream of gold coming through. I don't know whether that's from business he owns somewhere else, or just he has a stack of cash sitting back somewhere. Couldn't say. He always pays me well, I know that much.
Well, he certainly chooses not to wear his wealth, that's for sure.
You know, mm-hmm. I keep talking him into buying some new clothes, but he just refuses. I sold him one set of clothes I'd gotten in a far-off land, and he stuck with it.
I happen to like his crick robes, thank you very much. And I would like to purchase a pair myself.
Of course. You know, I haven't had any come back in. It came off a very far-off land. It was some sort of old elven ceremony robe, from one of the tribes out across the sea.
The Crick Elves. I knew it. My long-lost brethren. Now, sir, do you happen to know where I might be able to purchase some sea turtles?
I'm a purveyor of fine goods. I can get a lot of things. I don't think I've ever had sea... Do you want them live or dead?
Oh, it doesn't really matter to me one way or another. They both end up the same way.
On a stick.
That's right, on a stick.
You know, I can't say I've had a couple sea turtle shells come through, but that was years ago. I haven't seen any in a very long time. These waters are more fishing waters, less turtle.
That's fine. I like to wrestle the turtles down myself anyway. Do you have any rope?
Absolutely, I do. How much would you like?
Well, at least double my own height.
I'll say that 50 feet's normally what people buy. It's a good length. You can cut it up if you need it.
That's I
don't think he kind of
at least
like,
four times more than me.
He looks at his hands and goes, I don't think 10 feet of rope's gonna do a bunch for you. And if you need him, you can just cut him up.
I'll take it.
50 will be fine.
Yeah, this should be good.
I will take your rope and your magic wand and some of those vials, sir.
So he pulls out, he starts making a small, it's a, like cloth sack, like a burlap sack. You see him shove the rope in. He hands you the metal tube. He goes, you hold on to that. That's very special. And he just kind of drops the vials down in the sack.
This is why they're called the shirt sack, guys. But I haven't seen a shirt since we've been in here.
If you're looking for clothes, I mostly make them on demand. You know, we can take some measurements, and in a few days I could have some.
I don't believe we'll be here in a few days. Perhaps you can wait on your clothing.
Well, here, let me take the measurements now. When you return from this quest, I'll have the shirt ready for you, or whatever you would like.
You know, sir, you are mighty fine. I'll take the deal.
All right.
Now make sure that it's got plenty of breathing holes because it gets real hot out on the creek.
Of course, that I totally understand. Standard mosh oil coming up. He starts scribbling on a piece of paper, and he takes a little measuring tape out and just a couple different dimensions. Goes, interesting. It's been a while since I've had a dwarf in here. Okay, I think I've got everything I need. With the deposit for the shirt and, let's see, 50 feet of rope, some of Tom's magic wands, and some vials, that'll be 1 gold and 2 silver.
How much money do we have on us? I don't even have my...
yours is different. You have about 5 gold.
Oh, okay. That's fine. I'll pay the man then.
Okay. So yeah, you dole out the gold. Is there anything else you gentlemen need?
Do you have any, like, climbing equipment? I'm thinking we might need to go...
You will have that in your adventurer's pack, or I think, yes, it's, I think it's called the explorer's pack. That's something you'd
perfect.
Now, what more do you need than a rope? And I got 50 whole feet of rope.
You actually already had 50 feet of rope in your sack as well. Now I have 100 feet.
I like rope almost as much as I like sticks. What can I say?
You can say, I think that's enough rope.
You don't know what I'm using it for.
Yeah, you'll have pitons.
No one does.
You'll have pitons in your explorers to hammer into a string rope through to climb stuff.
So. Cool.
You'll have torches and rations in there as well, so you don't really need to worry.
Let's
attach things to sticks.
I think. I think that's it.
So says, well, if you think of anything else before you embark on this adventure, please come by. Patronize me with your business.
Sounds good. Everybody good?
I'm good.
Thank you, sir, outside for your generosity today.
Finish my last mug of dragon ale.
He brought it with you to the store.
You brought the mug with you.
Yeah. You will say no to a dragon.
Fair point. The sun is starting to set. Starting to get a little dark. What are you guys doing? You have maybe about 30 minutes of light left. It seems like most of the people have cleared out. They're going to see lights. Lights from fires and hearths burning inside cotton.
Survey the area, see if there's any form of... I know this is a mining town, but perhaps they haven't leveled all of the trees around here.
You're looking for trees? Yeah. While it is a mining town, it's surrounded by forest. If you look on the map, it's a very dense forest pushing out away from the mountain, and that continues almost all the way up to the edge of the sea, which is... It's less beach and more... think like cliff sides of Dover, like just drop offs into the water. And there's small clearings as it gets closer to the water where the trees are they've been felled and cleared away for ships to come in and dock with the side of the cliff side. But for the most part, there are trees all over the place. You would have no trouble finding.
Now, you said that we got off the boat when we got here, right?
Yes. Yeah, it was gangplanks. It's like a dock side, but there's nothing else attached to it.
Okay,
they just kind of unloaded you and some supplies that they were selling.
So there's no like water side or like mud or anything else around.
No.
Surrounding it.
Yeah, it's like a rocky cliff face, and this wood pier kind of comes off. It's just wide enough for like one ship to dock at a time.
Okay.
There are no other ships docked in. It looks like some people have some boats that they've tied up down. They've put some stakes in the ground and tied boats off, further down the cliffside, but nothing at the dock right.
Hmm. All right. Biff is going to wander into the woods a little bit and then dig up some dirt and make a little dirt bed for the night.
I'm following to do similar, but with a little more tact for the
length. I head back to the inn at the tavern.
Okay.
Is there anything attached to the tavern?
No, the tavern's a freestanding building, a freestanding two-story building.
Okay.
Now, can I find any any things in the woods that I can go ahead and attach to some sticks before we set off on our quest?
Talk to me about what you're trying to do.
Okay. So I walk into the woods. Are there any rocks anywhere?
Yeah, there's there's pine small
cones?
Rocks.
Are there pine cones?
Yeah, sure. We can say this is a pine forest. Sure.
Okay. So I'm going to gather up as much pine cones and rocks as I can and attach it to the end of a stick and make a club.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So, go ahead and make a... You have tools, correct?
Yeah.
I can't remember what... did you pick carpenter's tools? I need to come standard with that. I could be wrong.
I did not pick carpenter's tools, I don't think. I don't remember seeing that anywhere. I have tinkerer's tools.
Tinkerer's tools. Yeah. With some effort, go ahead and make a... So you're going to roll your intelligence, add your proficiency, and that's going to be your tinkerer's tools check. I think that's how that works.
Okay, you said what? I'm going to add what?
So your intelligence modifier, proficiency. Mm-hmm. So right now your proficiency is a +2, so whatever your intelligence is, add it to that, and then roll a d20.
Okay, so 5 plus a 2?
Yeah.
All right, so 7. I get a 17.
Yeah, with a 17, it takes you about an hour, and as it gets dark, it's a little harder to see, but you think you've fashioned together a pretty decent rudimentary club.
I know my way around a stick.
Yeah, you and your friends back in the crypt, you've made stuff like this before, but this is a little more elegant. You know, using all the skills you've learned over your long life? I can't remember how old Biff is, to be honest.
Oh, I don't think we set age originally. I'm, I'm a seasoned dwarf, so I'm a little like close getting into middle age.
Okay. Yeah, so you in your years you've made crude weapons before. This one seems a little more focused and durable.
I think this'll do. This is a mighty fine stick. I'm gonna put this into my shirt sack.
All right, ballin'. So you said you were gonna try to make a dirt bed, but more tactfully so?
Yes, I would like to utilize a single action of plant growth to give myself a nice thicket to call home for the night.
Yeah, so as you're crafting this stick, Biff, you see Ballin kind of wave his hands around and mutter some phrases, and these little saplings push up out of the ground, and they turn into it looks like a moss, and then it grows into like this small soft bush that just sprouts and plops down on top of the grass.
Boy, I wonder what kind of stick he's got for that kind of magic.
So, you two back at the tavern. I assume you're shacking up together? Fair assumption?
You shacking up together?
Servo, that's more of a question for you. Are you going to tell
me? Both of you? I mean, if there's only one bed, I don't know how that's going to work. I
figure since I come from a monastery, I don't need a bed. I can just meditate. You just sit down in the corner and meditate. aka sleep.
Yeah, so as a monk, you've definitely had time where you've slept on the ground or, you know, in very uncomfortable environments. Right. So sleeping's really not that big of an issue for you, as long as it's not you know, on top of broken glass. So, yeah. you guys go up to the room and Zarkle just kind of plops down over in the corner and just nods off, and Servo goes to sleep. We're going to go ahead and call that the end of the day. So you two out in the forest, y'all just going straight to sleep?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm nice and comfy. It's almost like the creek. I can smell the seawater just rolling in. So I just kind of mud myself up and pass out.
Question, can y'all see that?
Yes.
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 Okay. I need to figure out how to not do that. There's a way to hide that. It's not important for now, though. Yeah, so you guys go to sleep. Nothing happens throughout the night. I would say, Biff, you wake up throughout the night, and you notice, like, some flies or something just kind of, like insects kind of gathering around you. And it's not out of the ordinary, but... You know, it's definitely a little uncomfortable. They're a little bigger than what you're used to. But other than that, restful sleep for everybody.
I'm gonna grab a couple of those and put them on my mouth and call it a midnight snack.
Good God. Okay. Sure. So yeah, you guys wake up. Y'all wake up from the bright light of the sun peering in. You two in peering in from the windows. The other two, obviously, you're outside. So sunlight wakes you. It's morning. You guys all hear that the town's starting to pick up. You get the faint smell of people cooking in the morning. There may be a bakery somewhere around. You can smell fresh bread coming through the scents of the smoke and the effervescent just soot that covers the town seemingly. What are you guys doing?
I go out into the tavern to see if I can get something to eat early in the morning.
Yeah. So, Cyril sits you down and, she offers for a couple of copper. She can offer a breakfast, some eggs and bacon, simple staples, a little bit of bread on the side.
I get it.
Yeah. So, you sit down for breakfast. I assume, Zarkle's following.
I don't know. Are you awake, Zarkle?
Do they have any live animals?
He's
Sarah goes, what kind of live animal?
The usual.
The usual
chickens or
we have chickens. Do you want it live?
Yes.
She kind of looks puzzled at you. Just I mean, all right, but I'd really like it if you didn't. And she kind of like, she's putting it together. She goes, if you didn't eat it inside? She goes, it would be a little bit of a mess. How about I just get you a chicken? I can get them to roast it for you back in the kitchen. Is live a prerequisite? A necessity, you might say?
I'll try this roasted chicken, as you say.
I assure you, we have a delicious set of spice. It'll do the job. So, she motions back into the kitchen and yells some like speech that isn't seemingly intelligible to you. But a little bit later, a small child comes out carrying two plates and plops it in front of you for your meals. There's a large roast chicken with nothing else on the plate. Just head chopped off, feet chopped off, in front of you, and your plate of eggs and bacon, Servo.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Delicious.
What are you guys in the woods doing?
Biff is going to get up, and he's going to take his magic stick out of the sack and start filling up some of the vial, and then blow it a little bit as he's walking back to town. Just to test it out, just to see what the magic's about.
Yeah, so you swish it around in this little vial, and you start going just like Tom did, and little bubbles start appearing out of the end of the metal tube and just skittering around the environment. And the wind, as the wind picks up, you notice the bubbles get carried away.
That is a mighty fine stick. I'm gonna kind of wander and see where the bubbles are going, because I'm really curious about these. So I'm gonna follow them.
When they're getting carried off in the wind, they only fly about a foot or two away from you and pop. The other bubbles are, whenever you're blowing bubbles, the wind's not blowing, they kind of just go out in front of you for about 6 inches or so and slowly sink into the ground. Which I guess you'd be walking into as you walk into town.
Okay, so I'm just going to keep blowing bubbles as I walk back towards town.
Sure thing.
And then I catch a whiff of the food. And, you know, we don't got fine cooking like that out here on the creek, so I'm gonna see what kind of neat new sea creek seasoning they got.
Yes, yeah, so you notice it's coming from the Griffin's Nest, the inn you were in earlier.
Okay,
are you following?
Is there anything on the way from here to the Griffin's the place the
just some houses from where you guys are coming from?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Ballin, are you tying along?
I'm surveying the immediate area after from where I woke up to see if I can find any trees of oak.
Okay, sure. Make a perception check. Yeah, 14. You start to wander around. You know that generally this, if it's a pine forest, oaks wouldn't grow alongside it. You wander for about 5 minutes and you do find a small oak. I wouldn't say sapling, but it's not a full grown, one of those big 300-year oak trees. Maybe 20 or 25 years old. So it's large enough to like climb theoretically, but it's not some huge giant behemoth of a tree.
Well, then I'd like to respectfully shave some of its bark to take back to town with me.
Okay, sure. Yeah, so you kind of pry off a little bit of the oak bark and throw it in your bag and head back into town. Where are you going from there? I would say while you're wandering outside of your companion.
One more time. Kind of cut out there.
Where are you going from there? You've lost sight of your companion when you were looking at the tree.
Headed back to the bar. Figure I'll run into somebody.
Yeah, inns are generally a good place to get a night if you're looking for. So yeah, you two at the bar are eating your food, and you see in walking the door, blowing his little magical stick and bubbles coming out. You see Biff wander in.
Guys, do you see this?
He is clearly thrilled by his bubble.
This is Crick sorcery.
Good job. Good job.
You got him. You got him, Biff.
Just, wander over and sit down at the table with them, just blowing bubbles into the air.
Cheers. Cyril at the bar goes, I see you've met Tom.
And a mighty fine man he is.
I knew you'd like him.
He gave me this magic stick. Now, what kind of crick food you got here?
I have a standard breakfast of food. I do not know this crick food that you speak of.
Just get regular food, Biff. They have regular food.
Every food's crick food when you eat it out by the crick, all right? Now what?
Just get him some crick food, please.
Biff.
She knows the biggest sure thing.
Try this roast chicken.
You see a small plate of eggs and bacon in front of Servo, and you see a whole roast chicken in front of the dragonborn. And he offers you a piece.
I will graciously accept your chicken. That looks like a crick chicken.
It is. Just like it.
She comes back with a small plate of bacon and eggs and slides it. And Sarah looks over at you, Zarkle, and goes, "And how was the chicken? I hope it satisfied your needs."
Yeah.
Very well then, I apologize for lacking food diversity. She's at a loss for words. How about you, sir? What can I get for you? She motions to the tiefling.
Out of curiosity, do you have more of that chicken? It looks delightful.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I can grab some for you. She leans back and yells something back into the kitchen. A few minutes later, another roast chicken pops out. A little child just slides the plate across and skitters back off into the kitchen. All right, so after you guys eat breakfast, what is the plan? What are you guys going to do?
I guess it's time to head out for Stone Tooth. Old Stone Tooth.
That's right, we're going to go head out to Biff's Creek.
It's not Biff's Creek yet.
It's Biff's Creek. Listen, we know that this creek is going to be mine.
Sure.
So. I need a creek. They have a creek. This is going to be my creek.
So,
What if I would like to lay Craig to this creek?
Well,
after you dried up the last one?
You're going to have to take that up with the cartographer. That guy. With the the map man, that man we spoke to yesterday, you're gonna have to take it up with him. This is my crick. He already promised it to me.
Oh god. There you go. So as you travel north from the mining town. Sorry, go ahead, Zarkle.
Biff, he did not promise you the crick.
Everybody else heard it. He promised me a crick.
No, I told you there was someone to name the creek. Yeah. He did not promise the creek to you.
It's my creek. Listen, we can butt heads all day, but at the end of the day, I know cricks. That's a creek. It's my creek.
Biff, I will make you a deal. If you can beat me to the creek, then I will help you name the creek after you.
I'll take that deal. Ain't nobody knows how to find a crick faster than Biff.
Okay. So
is Biff sitting next to me or across from me?
Oh, you guys have already left the tavern. You've eaten your food and you're walking out now.
Peace out.
Which one's going?
Oh.
Just like that. Tavern out!
I am very excited to see where this goes. Okay, good God. All right. So you guys are outside. You're having this conversation pretty much right in front of the end. So what? I hesitate to say let's roll for initiative, but you guys are racing for the creek?
That's right, we're racing for the creek.
All right.
Is it like a 3 days journey to this creek?
it's about a 3 days journey to the top of the mountain, to like where the. Okay.
So how far is it to the creek? Say,
Servo, I think you're muted.
I am.
Okay, just making sure you know. I saw the icon pop up. I'm like, ooh. All right. What? I'm just gonna say let's roll for initiative here. You two go ahead and roll a d20 and add your dexterity modifiers.
Had to be dexterity.
Yeah, you're racing, man. Oh, and I think we actually have that labeled incorrectly, Biff. I believe dwarves a walking speed of 25 feet. Double check that.
I get 25 whole feet when I walk?
Well, most people get 30 is the issue.
That's a lot of crick shoes to buy.
Yeah, 25 feet.
Huh.
Yeah. Let's see. Okay. Alright. So, while as soon as you say, we'll race to the crick, Biff tears off running. He doesn't even wait to hear the full sentence. So he gets the drop on you, but you know dwarves. There's no way he's beating you to this creek. I mean, you are faster than him in every metric, unless he has a spell like fly, not a chance. So you chase after him, and for about 10 seconds, Biff, you think, I guess 12 seconds, you're like, oh, I got this. I am making that crick before he gets there. There's no way. And you just hear, thump, 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 thump. And you see this dragonborn moving faster than people normally should, just whoosh, sprint by you. And he is out of sight before you even realize that of what's going on. So, you two, I assume you're following the foot race?
At my leisure.
Okay.
Yep, I have no interest in naming something that can't be owned by man.
Sure. Yeah.
No, and I'm definitely a lot more cautious at this particular point, just making sure that there's nothing that we didn't hear about that might impede our quest.
Yeah, so you guys walk at normal speeds, and you see that you guys watch as Biff take off running, and you see Zarkul almost comically like wait and get him down into a sprinting stance and then tear off and pass Biff almost immediately, and it's just gone. You guys follow behind. After about 10 minutes of, I guess, less time for Zarkul, after about 10 minutes of you two running, you hear the sounds of rushing water and get to the creek's edge. It's a small winding creek with a small stone path next to it, seemingly winding through the woods. As you travel north in the mining town, you pass through Brooding Pines Forest and Deep Vales. Where you stand now, you catch the sight of a tall hill that rises to a prominent bare the Stone Tooth. You can make out a steep, narrow track that runs alongside the river going up the mountain. And after about 20 minutes, you two who are walking catch up to them. Are you guys, I assume you guys are waiting at the creek's edge for your companions?
Yeah, we got to the creek's edge, and I'm like, all right, you got me. I'll find a new creek, a better creek.
You beat him by about 2 minutes to the edge of this creek. So you've not only like been there for a minute, you've already caught your breath and like out of sprinting. You're no longer panting. You're just kind of hanging out.
I'm gonna take a look around and see what kind of life is around this creek. Just because I want more stuff to attach to my stick.
You see some small little minnows swimming through the water, but nothing of real note. You know, it's a fishing hole you've seen the likes of fishing holes like this in the past, but there's nothing really that you see that would jump out as I need to have that.
Okay, and you said that we saw like a little path that led into a shrine kind of thing.
It's a small winding road that runs up the hill.
Okay.
Up the hillside that follows. It kind of follows the. It looks like it may have been a more elaborate road in the past, but over time, weathering that the river provides and just time itself, it's worn away and is now just kind of bare stone steps that crisscross up the mountainside. Yeah, you two catch up and you see a... it's been 10 minutes, but Biff is still slowly catching his breath. He's almost there, but you can tell he's a little exasperated from running so far. This is not a distance to go for. You also see a thin river with a small road that winds across the side.
Let's see. I guess we would start making our way up. I mean, if we don't see anything else, so I guess I'd look around for something else.
Okay, make a perception check for me.
Okay.
Oh, sorry. What exactly are you looking for? I just want to make sure it's the right check.
Basically just any other sign that might lead me down a different path other than the obvious one.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, perception, I guess.
Okay. I think it's just base. It's at 8, so what, -1?
Yes.
Okay. So 10.
A 10? You search around, you don't see any evidence of any other paths coming off. You see small children's footprints, but nothing really else of note.
No.
These footprints just go up to the creek's edge and back into towards town.
How big is this creek?
About 10 feet across.
About 10 feet across? Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, while we're just here, once everybody catches up, can I take a quick creek bath? I just want to splash some water on myself. Feel some cool water down on me.
Absolutely. So yeah, while you guys are inspecting the area, Biff walks over and just starts splashing his face with water to clean himself.
Oh, I'm jumping right in.
Okay. He doesn't splash his face. He jumps into the creek. And starts washing up. Make a would you have sealed up the soap, the vial of soap that you were blowing bubbles from? Is that something Biff would normally do?
Absolutely not.
Okay, cool. So you had 3 vials. The one you were using to blow it's now effectively empty. But you notice like the sack that you were holding on to with all your supplies in it, has some bubbles coming out of it. It's like a frothy. It's not like blood or frothy mixture.
Guys, look! This is a magic creek.
Just let it go.
It's clearly just soapy water.
This is where the shirt sack guy gets all of his magic from.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is. You've solved the mystery. No.
This is his first bath, guys.
Guys,
at least with soap. Yeah.
When we come back, remind me to get some of this creek water because this is magic.
You got it.
You don't have any vials, Biff. We can't carry the magic creek water back.
Well, he does now have the empty vial.
And that I have
the soap was in.
I have 2 full vials still.
That you do. You do have 2 full vials left of that soapy mixture.
Uh huh.
So Biff, you could fill one up now if you wanted to, if you're interested.
No. We don't know what else we might need later on. I might need to fill this vial up with my own spit, maybe. So it sometimes you gotta be a little creative out on the creek. So I'm gonna wait until we are coming back, and then I'm gonna have this for the rest of the journey.
Okay. All
right. So this is a very thin river, right? I guess it's not far to get to the other side.
It's about 10 feet wide. It winds and narrows just as it winds up the hill, but on average about 10 feet wide.
And like how deep is it? He jumped in, but like is it?
He jumped
deep?
In as a dwarf. It's coming up to about his chest height, so 2.5 okay. 3 feet deep.
Gotcha. All right, I trod through and go to the other side.
Okay, sure.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, you hop through and there's a little bit of a push coming from the water, but it's not anything that like drags you away. You feel little fish hit you as little minnows swim by. You feel a couple touch your legs as you're walking forever.
Perfect.
So we've got one in the water, one across the river, and two on the side of the road.
Can I wade in and catch a minnow?
Sure. Yeah. You wade in. It's about... It's a little bit below your waist. As a dragonborn, you're really tall. So it's not nearly as hard to... make a sleight of hand check? No, survival check. A survival check.
Survival.
Or I would say survival or sleight of hand, whichever. Sleight of hand is probably going to be higher for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so as you kind of wade out of the water and just get real still, but your hand is just cocked back ready to strike, and you wait and wait, and just, boom, you fling your hand in and just barely grab the tail of this minnow. I mean, it's a little itty bitty fish, and it's just flopping around in your hand. You have, in fact, caught a minnow.
I take it with me to the other side.
Okay, you bring the minnow to the other side of the... Ballin, or are you... what are you doing right now?
Well, me, I'm just waiting to see if I can find anything remotely indicative of anyone else that has tried to follow this path other than us.
Make an investigation check. Yeah, so with a 19, yeah. You sit there kind of looking around specifically for tracks, and you see a... you look down and you see a couple of tracks that look like three or four boot tracks. You can't say for sure. They've wandered down this trail recently. You can't say for sure just because you're slightly unfamiliar with the territory. You think it's within a week. They're definitely not old tracks. But it looks like they wind up this road. That alongside the stony road.
Well, in that case, I think I'm going to take a look around the tracks and just see if anything stands out, see if anyone left anything behind. I'm still not even sure about the legitimacy of this quest, to be honest.
So the 19, all you really find are the... there's nothing else of serious note right here. You find these footprints of these people walking up. You also see footprints of some smaller bare feet. Looks like kids' footprints that came up to the stream and then go right back down the hill toward.
Well, I think I'm just going to find a nice tree to lean up against while Dragon Man fetches his fish and Crick Man does something unspeakly with a stick, probably.
So is the plan you guys are going to kind of wait a little bit?
I'm basically waiting on them to get done. I'm ready to head up the trail towards the mountain.
Agreed.
Cool. Yeah. Talk amongst yourselves. Make some plans.
Hey Biff. What? Look at this. I use prestidigitation and make a kind of like colorful thing to attract his attention in my direction.
Yeah, so you wave your hand and like it's like a like a shower of sparks and illusory confetti just goes out of your hand and just like kind of just showers over the area and vanishes.
Whoa, that's gotta be like three magic stick. And I'm just kind of swim my way over to him.
We should check up the trail to see if there's anything else like that.
I'll follow his lead.
Okay.
Dragon Man, you done with that fish yet?
I'm taking it with us. Yes, the fish is okay. Coming with us.
What's left of it? He's like munching on it.
Okay, so you guys travel up this trail without issue. You're not following the side with the road on it, correct? You're following along the opposite creek side?
What side were you on, Servo?
I thought you said that the trail was on the other side. That's why I went over there.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, you guys were on the side that the trail was winding up.
I come back and I follow the trail.
Okay. So, yeah, you guys are...
Agreed.
You guys are walking up the trailhead. Ballin, you notice that these tracks seem to like go up and down. It seems like there's more people making more trips. It's seemingly a little well traveled, but it's the same footprints each time. It's the same set of three or four people. You know, sometimes it looks like it's two, sometimes it looks like it could be as many as five. It's hard to tell. They're kind of smashed over top each other. But it's definitely one set of people. So you guys wander up without issue for most of the day. On foot, you get to about here. You guys can see that on the map, right?
I don't see anything apart from just the... Oh, nope, now I do.
Okay, so there's a small clearing that opens up. There's evidence of campfires in the past, but nobody's there. There's no like smoldering campfire, you know, pits or anything. It's just there's a clearing that looks like it'd be ripe for a campfire, and there's a clearing, a small circular clearing where it's clear people have lit fires in the past.
Okay.
The sun has started to set. What are you guys doing?
I suggest that we should probably make camp for the night here.
I can make a bonfire. I cast
no
bonfire over the fire ground.
Yeah, so Biff reaches into his pack, and while you guys go, no, he throws a small stick that kind of grows in size and multiplies and just goes and they just kind of bash across the ground into this circle, and a bonfire lights up.
See? Bonkers. Look at that. Magic stick.
I don't think we want to draw that much attention to ourselves.
But stick.
When you say bonfire, I'm thinking like,
like
bonfire?
No.
It's like a
campfire.
It's a good sized campfire.
So isn't it like 5 foot radius?
Yeah, it's a 5 foot cube. It occupies the space that one person does in a fight, essentially.
Okay.
5 foot by 5 foot. It's a good sized bonfire. It's a good sized campfire.
That was
thick. He made from a stick he threw out of his pack.
Now, Dragon Boy, you still have that fish you found earlier?
No, but it was quite good.
Guess Biff's eating sticks again tonight.
You say steaks?
I said sticks.
Do you have any sticks that turn into steaks?
I can make you steak. A steak out since, of the shape of sticks.
Since we're out in the woods, is there any like gamey type animals? Rabbits.
Yeah, you guys could search for little animals before you settle down.
Oh, perfect. Can I go ahead and sharpen a stick into a spear? And then go try to hunt some animals?
I would think with your history, you would already have a special
stick. No. I make it as I need. So I'm going to take a stick and I'm going to put it in my mouth. And then shred off pieces of it until it forms a sharp point.
Yeah, that tracks. Sure. Yeah, you make a spear. The other gentlemen can use their actual weapons for hunting animals. Yeah, I want everybody to make a survival check who wants to go hunt.
Okay. I don't do that.
Okay. So yeah, you stay at the camp and I would assume set up a bedroll, that sort of thing.
I munch on some crackers from my back, you know, no big deal.
Good. That's good. Anybody else hunting?
No, good. I'll just see.
Okay, that's a crit fail for Zarkle. All right.
Crackers Ballinard.
I think I'll just conjure up a handful of good berries.
Nah, you got it.
Yeah, so you reach into your bag and pull out a sprig of mistletoe, and you whisper a few words, and they just kind of like there's little branches that veer off the mistletoe, sprout berries, and just drop off into your lap. And 10 good berries drop into your lap. You two are wandering in the woods, and you can tell it's definitely Zarkle's first time hunting. And you're trying to instruct him on how to, you know, be stealthy and track, and he knows how to be stealthy, so he's ignoring. But he doesn't understand that's a different kind of skill set for tracking animals. And the one rabbit you do manage to find, you throw your spear, Biff, you throw your spear at it, and it gets pretty close, but it does not make contact with the rabbit. It scurries off into the woods.
Now you see, Dragon Man, that's what we call a diversion. I tricked that rabbit into thinking that I was going to hit it, but really, it's going to go back to its family and gather them all up so that we can get them all. That's a crick move.
Let's go back to the bonfire.
Okay.
I got plenty of sticks if you want some.
See, Zarkle walks back into camp empty-handed. No Biff in tow. After a little more time, Biff comes back and empty-handed as well, having no luck finding his family of rabbits he was hunting so hard for. So you guys bed down for the night. Are you guys all going to sleep? Anybody taking?
Yeah, I go to sleep. I don't think I have any reason to stay up.
Okay. I'll stay up, but that's because I want to play around and find some more sticks. I never know when I'm gonna need some more sticks in my supply.
So yeah, you take about 10 minutes and you find some sticks without issue. The rest of y'all are bedding down?
Yep.
Cool. Yes. So yeah,
yes, I assume my monk pose and...
Yeah, Zarkle plops his giant body down, puts his hands together in a small triangle, and begins to meditate, and you guys notice he just kind of slumps over asleep and seemingly seconds. Let me try this. That didn't work. Cool. Perfect.
You could just roll some physical dice over there and we'd be none the wiser.
I'm gonna set up the hiding things later. Plus I'd like to see I'd like y'all to see the doom that so you guys in the middle of the night wake up to the sounds of sniffing. And it seems like something may be rummaging through one of your packs. Everybody roll initiative. I got really nice little dice.
Do 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 initiative. Dun, 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 ba-dum.
It's just a straight up roll, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought. Yeah, because we're setting turn order.
Gotcha.
Let's see. You guys need to be adding your modifiers to this. Double check what your modifiers are real quick for initiative. It should be in the initiative box on your character sheet.
Oh.
Plus two.
Oh, I don't have modifiers for initiative.
What's your dexterity?
Zero.
Minus one. It's zero. Okay, cool. You're just flat.
12.
Say that one more time.
12.
So that's a plus one.
Gotcha. Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah.
Good old minus one here.
Mm-hmm. I still got the lowest.
I'm so excited to put this stick into action.
So at the top of the order is Zark. Wake up, you look around, you see two wolves rummaging through the packs in the middle of the close to the campfire. What are you doing?
No, I see two wolves.
Yes, you see two wolves.
My dragon breath is... It doesn't take any special moves, so...
No, I believe it's an action, and I believe it's a straight line shot.
Straight line shot?
Mm-hmm.
Are there a difference in the size of the wolves? Or?
No, they're both about the same size. They're big, but they're not abnormally large by any means. They're not dire wolves.
All I have is a simple weapon, right?
Yeah, you would have a... I think we talked about a short sword. So you can add your dexterity to that attack. Dexterity and proficiency.
Actually, this is... let me go unarmed.
Okay.
Plus four for attack. 1d4 plus two.
So you're making an unarmed strike?
Yeah.
So you're going to roll a d20, add your proficiency and your dexterity. So your proficiency is plus two, and then add your dexterity.
Proficiency. Oh, found it. And dexterity. So that's two, so that's plus four.
Formula load, something like that. Great. Yeah, that's a hit. So you kind of sneak up behind these wolves who are none the wiser. You know, they're still rummaging through this packs for whatever rations are inside. And you rear back and just drive your palm into the side of the wolf. Go ahead and roll damage for me. So they 1d4 plus 2.
D4 plus 2.
Or damage. So yeah, you strike one of the wolves in the side of the head, and you hear the wolf go, ow! As it cries out in pain. but it is still standing. Now, are you going to do anything with your bonus action? Spend any key?
Bonus action.
You can spend key points to make another arm attack using Flurry of Blows.
So it's still standing. It's in closer, or did I push it any, or is it just?
No, it's still, you hit it real hard with
okay
the sun of your palm, and just it's still standing where it is.
Yeah, I'm bludgeoning it again.
Okay, so yeah, you'll spend one, I think it's one key point, and make another unarmed attack. Your second attack, the wolf now knows you're coming, and it dodges out of the way when you strike with the second palm. Will not connect. Next come up is Biff. Biff, you woke up to the scream of a, or the squeal of a dog in pain.
Oh, just another day on the crick.
Yeah, you wake up and you see two wolves rummaging through one of your packs.
I'm gonna take out my fastened pinecone rock stick.
Mm-hmm.
And And I'm gonna go swing at one of the dogs.
Sure, so go ahead and make an attack roll for me.
Yeah, what is my attack?
Strength plus proficiency.
Plus proficiency. What's my proficiency?
Two.
Oh, so strength plus, okay, two plus two. What am I rolling?
Is it D20.
D20, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're still getting a feel. You know, every new weapon needs a broken-in period. You bring this club down, and... Sorry, my Alexa's letting me know that there's a tornado warning. You bring your club down, and you kind of just, you're not used to the weight just yet, and it comes down just a little shy of the wolf. It leans out of the way as your club swings through the air, and it snarls back at you. Do anything with a bonus action?
With my bonus action, I'm going to take out some of my pebbles from my shirt sack and mm-hmm. imbue them with magic.
Sure. Yeah, you use a magic stone.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Okay. Next up is the wolves. We're going to make so they're going to make they have pack tactics, which allows them advantage. So they're going to roll dice and take twice and take the higher of the roll for the attack. They're going to attack the monk Zarkul, because he's the only one who's done damage so far. Does an 18 hit your armor class, Zarkul?
It does.
So it is going to bite at you. And it does 5 points of piercing damage, clamps down on your arm. I'm going to need you to make a strength saving throw. Something you didn't need to know yet. So you're going to roll, if you have anything, I don't think you do as a monk, in the savings throw section on your character sheet, you'll have a number next to strength. Roll with that modifier.
Let's see.
Oh, you do have proficiency, so it's going to be a plus three bonus to your roll. So it's going to be a d20 plus three.
Oh. Didn't recognize that. How about that one?
Perfect. So it clamps down and tries to, like, roll over and drag it to the ground with it, but you shake it off, and its whip fails, and its bite fails, and it falls back down, and is ready to pounce again. The second wolf is going to get, is a 14 enough to hit you, Zarkle?
Yes, just barely.
Just barely. Okay, so the second wolf pulls its head out of the pack, hearing its pack mate wince in pain. Takes a clamp down on you, and will do an additional 4 damage as it bites into your arm. And go ahead and make another strength check. Or strength save, sorry. Strength save. So, if you just press up... If you press up on the arrow key and tap last roll, you can just do that same roll again. Perfect. Yeah, it's plenty. It tries to do the same maneuver. Clearly a tried and true tactic, but... and you shake off the bite, and they're ready to pounce it. Now we are down to Ball. So Ballin, you wake up, sounds of some fighting and some dogs wincing and some snarling and some biting, and you see two wolves and two of your companions in combat with them.
I am going to... I'm going to utilize poison spray on the one that's going after Dragon Man.
Okay, so they're both going off after Zarkle. One has taken a little bit of damage. It has some blood running down the side of its face. The other, clean and pristine.
Take the cleaner of the two.
Okay. Make sure... Yeah, okay, so I gotta make a con save with that. And wolves, not so great at constitution. They're not bad. It's a 17. So you have a spell save DC on your character sheet?
Got... Does not appear so.
So it looks like it's a 12.
Yes. 1d12.
So yeah, a 17 will unfortunately be a little bit off. So you throw this small mote of green ooze out of your fingers. It floats over and hits the wolf in the face, and the wolf breathes in and just shakes it off. We are now down to Servos. Servo at twitch.tv. You wake up and you see a little fight ensuing between your companions and two wolves.
Sorry, what's... I felt that one coming a mile away.
Servo, right. Bless.
Thank you. So they're... Wait, would you say they're between me and them?
You wake up and they're pushed off to the side where you have set your packs down. Mm-hmm. And your companions are fighting next. They're all in melee. Except for Ballin.
Okay.
Wolves.
Let's see here. What weapons do I have on me? What weapons do I have on
me? I believe you have a crossbow as well. Your spells.
Good. Okay. Man.
Should be on your character sheet.
I'm gonna imagine that my type of personality would load the crossbow before going to bed in the woods. So I'm gonna go for a crossbow.
Yeah, you as an action to fire the crossbow, loading is included.
I will load and attempt to fire the cross.
Sure. So go ahead and roll a d20. And roll an attack. Efficiency plus attack.
Let's see. Attack is...
Sorry, it's your dexterity plus proficiency.
I don't believe I have a proficiency with this, do I? So there's no added bonus to that.
You should. Right?
I do. Okay.
Could be wrong.
I don't know that I do or not.
After the fact, if not, but
okay, no big deal. Yeah, I roll.
Yeah, that's plenty. Okay. So you're gonna hit. Which wolf are you targeting? The one that's taking a little damage? Not.
The one that had.
Okay, go ahead and roll damage for me.
Gotta get that final hit, and then that's just another d20, right?
No, crossbow is a. It's a D8, so you roll a D8, and add your dexterity to it.
Okay, so I actually get a minus, I believe, because it's my dexterity. Is
okay, yeah.
Alright. So 5.
Yeah. You can also add that after roll, say, slash roll 1D8 minus 1.
Oh, I'm just clicking the little dice buttons over here.
Oh yeah, okay, yeah, I've been typing. Right, you can do that. So yeah, you do. You fire off this crossbow, and it has a meaty hit in the side of that wolf, and it winces in pain and drops down to its belly for a second, and slowly gets back on its feet and kind of snarls weakly at y'all. It's still standing, but it's taking a good bit of damage. We are back at the top with Zarkul. Zarkul, you've seen some damage fly from your companions. The one that you hit initially is very hurt, but still up. The other has not taken any damage.
I'll attempt to finish off the one that's damaged.
Sure. Go ahead and roll an attack roll.
I'm doing unarmed, so that's my d20 plus 4.
Mm-hmm.
Good hit.
So a 10 unfortunately will miss.
Damn it.
You come back with another strike, and you try to hit it right in the nose and try to break its nose, and just he dodges out of the way, and your hand makes glances off the side of the ball. You're back up to your fighting pose. Biff, you are up.
Okay. So with actions and bonus actions, just a quick question. Sure. Am I able to strike and then with the bonus action throw my stones?
No, I believe throwing a stone is a ranged attack, which is your action.
Okay. How far away am I from the wolves?
You're within melee range, so within 5 feet. If you're gonna throw a stone, it will be at disadvantage because you're making a ranged attack in melee.
Okay, good. That's what I wanted to check then. I'm gonna run and try and strike the damaged wolf with my pinecone stick.
Okay. Go ahead and roll an attack roll for me. That will not be enough, unfortunately. You kind of drive it in like a spear, and the wolf kind of sidesteps you, and you drive the stick into the mud, and you pull back ready to swing again. But now, it is the wolf's turn.
Do I not get another bonus action?
Oh yeah, you can take a bonus action if you have one.
So I'm gonna just shout with righteous fury and cast magic weapon on my pinecone stick.
Sure. In the future, you can do that before. Just throwing that out there.
Yeah, but I figured if I miss it, it'd be better for dramatic effect.
Yeah, you scream in rage, gosh darn it, and now his stick is glowing with a very faint arcane energy. Does that give you an attack bonus?
It does. It does.
Okay. Okay, cool. So it's the wolf's turn now. So the wolf who's taken a good bit of damage he's actually going to leave your threatened area to go attack Servo, because Servo did a hell of a lot of damage to it.
Nah.
So anybody who is in melee range, so Biff and Zarkul, you can take what's called attacks of opportunity. It's using your reaction to make an attack as someone leaves your threatened area. So moves out of, basically moves out of range and like doesn't pay attention leaving. So you both can choose to make an attack of opportunity if you would like.
Can I throw my stones now?
No, it would still be a disadvantage.
Oh, okay. Okay. I thought they were moving out of my range.
It's before it leaves your threatened range.
Okay.
It's kind of like it turning away from us to run.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So are we at advantage then if they're turning away from us?
No, the attack is the free action.
Okay.
It's using your reaction, which you technically get once every turn, but there's a couple uses for it.
So yeah, I'm just going to react and swing my stick around and whichever wolf is closest to me.
Well, this is the damaged wolf who's leaving your threatened area.
Okay.
So you're going to take a swing
at that. The other one's still there.
Yeah. Zarkle, are you also making a attack of opportunity?
Yes.
Okay, so both of y'all roll attack rolls. We'll take Zarkle because he's slightly faster first.
Yeah, we've proven I was faster.
So go ahead and make that attack roll.
That's my same d20 plus 4.
Mm-hmm.
Damn it!
Yeah, so you did not expect him to... Both of y'all did not expect this wolf to turn and run after taking bites of both of you. It managed to get out.
It's just another plus one. It wouldn't have mattered.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately, that wouldn't be enough. Anyways. This wolf managed to dodge your attacks and Servo and makes an attack. He will not have advantage because he's left his friend behind. That is a 13 to hit.
To hit who? Me?
To hit Servo.
Me.
Oh.
I'm sorry, what is that against?
Your AC, your armor class. Should be in the top left of your sheet.
Next to your initiative and speed.
So you guys are looking at the completed sheet on mine for some reason.
Oh, yeah, I see.
Still looking at the figure version. So, as far as I'm aware,
it's going to be plus one. So you have a DC of... should be 12. Should be 12. I think you get light armor. So sorry, it's been a long time. That will unfortunately he will hit. So he comes down and clamps on his leg for 5 points of piercing damage, and go ahead and make a saving throw as he tries to drag you down to the ground.
Okay.
Yeah, that's enough. Yeah, you kind of just shake your leg real hard and it bucks the wolf off, and he kind of flies a foot or two away from you and just ready back on you.
Gotcha.
The second wolf will attack. It's going to make a strike at Biff. And it will miss terribly. It comes up and snaps at you, and you take your stick and just like kind of block its jaw and just throw it back off of you, and it just right back into the same space at once.
No, wrong no damage crit, doggo.
Next up, Ball. You are up. You are about 20 feet away from Wolf 1. Wolf 2 is about 10 feet away from you. The injured wolf is in front of Servo. Say that.
Okay. Then... how messed up is Zarkle looking?
Zarkle, he's taking a little bit of damage, but he's well above half.
Okay.
And word of the wise, this is a nighttime encounter, so you'll get your health back after.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we'll go back to the rest afterwards.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, then in that case, I'm going to... attempt to swing on the closest one. Am I in range for that?
You can close the distance. You've got 30 feet of movement.
30 feet, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, then the
So you're going to close it on the one attack and serve?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so go ahead and make an attack roll.
Yes. Let's see. I'm trying to figure out what my plus...
Do you have a bonus to that?
It'd be what, since it's with a great club, is that still dex?
That would be, no, that would be strength.
Yes, be, plus one.
And plus your proficiency? Because you're proficient with it? So yeah, it's a plus three. So yeah, that will be enough to strike that damaged wolf. Go ahead and roll damage for him.
Great clubs. 1d8 plus 1.
Mm-hmm. Your club collides with the skull of the wolf, and you hear a whimper and silence as you drive this great club on top of the wolf's back, and it crumples into a heap and servant. Wolf 1 is gone. Wolf 2 still is up in front of you two. Servo, it is your turn. You saw Ball just bring down this great club right on the back of the lying in a heap in front of you, not moving.
Okay. Then, I guess the other one is further away, right? Not within melee distance.
He's about 15 feet away from you.
Okay. Is it possible to use Eldritch Blast at this point to try and attack it? Okay, yeah. All right.
So it's going to be a ranged spell attack.
Uh-huh.
So it's going to be your... No, you don't have your spell sheet ready. It's going to be charisma plus proficiency bonuses.
Okay, so that would be...
So choose your proficiency.
You said charisma. I have a 17 charisma and...
So that's a plus 3. So it'll be a plus 5 on that bonus to hit.
Okay. All right. So 13.
13 will hit. So roll damage for you is going to be 1d10 plus 3.
1d10. 8 plus 3?
Yeah. Yeah. That's 8 damage. It's a big meaty hit. So Servo raises his hand up and this streak of purple energy just whistles across the battlefield and slams into the side of this wolf. And it takes a large hit, but it is still standing, but very close to death. But back at the top of Zarkul, you saw this purple streak scream through the air between you and Biff and strike this wolf very hard. What are you doing?
I'm going to continue my bludgeon.
Okay.
Because it's worked so well in the past.
Make that attack roll for me. That'll hit. Yeah, so you just rear back with your fist and just... Yeah! And go ahead and roll damage for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's plenty. Yeah, you drive your fist straight through the wolf's rib cage, and you pull out, and it's just covered in gore, and the wolf falls over in a heap, and it is dead as well.
Can I lick my fingers at those?
Yes. Yes, you absolutely can. Yeah, you guys saw him punch a hole into the chest of the wolf and lick his fingers off after.
Well, boys, if we weren't having dinner already... I can make another bonfire.
So yeah, you guys staying up or are you going to bed down for the night?
Definitely going back to bed.
Okay.
Can we salvage anything from these wolves' fur or meat?
Can I take the wolves' fangs?
So we're going to make We're gonna make survival checks for that. Who's doing what?
I'd like to take the fur and make a cape.
Okay. Do you have a knife to skin it?
Holy
shit. So you get your short sword. With effort, you can probably do that, yeah. Yeah, go ahead and make a survival check. So we'll just say it's whatever your survival bonus. Yeah. You are skinning it with a short sword. Yeah, so skinning's not your forte. You do manage to pull some of the fur off, but it's they're kind of loose, jagged cuts that they wouldn't be worth a full pelt, but I'm sure you're sure someone can make a hat from it back in town.
Okay.
So just write down two tatters.
What was it?
Two tattered wolf pelts. Oh, actually, throw it down as well. Yeah, once I get you guys character sheets, we'll have this. This will be like going in your equipment set. Okay. And somebody said they wanted to take fangs.
I'm gonna rip the fangs out of it so I can make me one of them spear sticks.
Okay.
Or no, a saw stick. I wanna run the teeth down like a big saw blade.
Sure. Make a survival check with disadvantage.
With disadvantage.
Yes.
Minus what?
You're gonna roll twice and take the lower of the two.
Okay.
I'm gonna say because this is a fine surgery like.
Oh.
Yeah. So you take your hammer and a little chisel out of your pack and you try to chip away at these, and you get two or three usable teeth. Definitely not enough to create any sort of weapon, but it's a good little charm.
Just says you. I can make a spear out of that.
The rest are just splinters of bone where they've cracked as you drive your into the chisel and they just spray all over the ground. Anybody else doing anything with the wolves before they go to bed?
Are they? They're all done.
They're dead. Yes.
I mean, no. Everybody's done taking their pieces.
Well, I would like to try to retrieve some meat. It's senseless for them to go to waste.
Sure, yeah, go ahead and roll survival check. Also with advantage, because they've now been skinned. So roll twice and take the higher.
Is that d20?
Yes. Yep, d20 plus your survival.
If over here just rolls the short end of the sticks.
I got plus two survival. And. Hey.
Yeah. So you pull about 5 pounds of meat off of it. In Zarkle's attempt to skin it, he's definitely done some damage. A lot of the meat, so you're just kind of carving away bits and pieces. It's not like a chunk, it's just lumps of meat here and there. It comes to about 5.
That's a lot of meat.
To be cooked. It will need to be cooked at some point to save. I'll say that, like within the next. You know, basically as soon as the morning starts. But yeah.
I did offer to make a bonfire.
So you guys bed back down, sleep throughout the night without any other interruptions. And that's, I guess, where we're going to stop. It's 10:30. I feel like that's a good stopping point. We'll pick up at the.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
I would like to keep one of the wolf skulls.
Say again?
I'm just gonna hang on to one of the wolf skulls for later.
One of the wolf skulls? Yeah, go ahead and make us in the morning.
Yeah, it's already, you know, it's already dried out. It's like, it's all the time to grab one. just before I forget. Maybe.
So for the nine, you just kind of lop off the wolf's head. You try to scrape a lot of the meat off, but you're left with a skull that just has a lot of tendons. You know, it's not your best cleaning job.
Exactly what I was looking for.
Then you got it.
I walk back to my tent and I put it on my hand and start talking.
Yeah. Yeah, that's something you can do. Absolutely.
All right, cool. I'm cool to wrap there. I'm good.
No. It's like one of the Crick puppets we used to play with as a kid.
Good Lord.
I say this is slightly different, and I go off in the distance.
Yeah. I'm going to write that down, because we're...
It's like a body of water. It's like a small river, Haru.
Good God. Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to mark the page and pick up there next session.
Yep. Awesome. 2 weeks. 2 weeks from now.
2 weeks. Yep. So, did you guys have fun?
Oh yeah.
I had a blast. Did you have fun?
Oh, I had a great time.
Did we help you have fun?
He's not going to say we made it worse.
I mean, he fucking might.
It is going to be a lot of fun writing for you. Say that. This is going to be a joy for me. I'm very excited.
Next date would be May 8th.
May 8th sounds good to me.
Do it.
Perfect. Okay.
Locked and saved.
All right. Well, thank you everybody for hanging out. Thank you for all of the subs. Now that we're affiliate and that we have subs turned on.
Hey.
Hey. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So much love and support. I'm glad that everybody had a blast in chat too. Servo, when are you going? You going live?
Yeah, here in a little bit.
Here in a little bit. Okay, I was gonna say, do we want to wait and then we can just send everybody over to you?
That's cool with me.
Okay, so we'll hang out. If you want to go ahead and jump over and prep up and everything, unless you want to say any other words or whatnot, jump
over to this screen. Oh yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you again, Austin, for DMing for us. It's honestly, the storytelling is great. I'm loving it. That's kind of, I think that's why I was like being so quiet, because it was kind of cool to hear you guys interact. But yeah, it's cool. So see you guys Sunday.
Yeah,
for the podcast
tomorrow.
And I'll see Moose tomorrow. That's right.
That's right. Tomorrow is Moose takes on Predator.
Predator Hunting Grounds, baby. It's finally there.
Are you ready, Moose?
As ready as I'll ever be. I've avoided everything. I didn't play the beta. I haven't watched any streams or YouTube content. I haven't watched a damn thing. I'm going into this blind and hopeful, baby. Blind and hopeful.
Gotta love when they're bloatful.
He could be hind. Blind. Hind.
What is
it? I like
you. He could be hope. Blind.
I like bloatful. I'm gonna stick with bloatful. That's what's gonna stay.
Oh
God, I'm excited. I can't wait to see if there was any clips from tonight or where you go back through the VOD from this, because this is a lot of fun. I'm excited to help experience this story with you guys. Austin, you're doing a great job so far.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm having a fun run for you guys. You guys are picking it up pretty well. I'm gonna try to have character sheets out to y'all. If you want to, I'll let you know when they're ready and we can pick them up at Darby's Dungeon. Should be there next week sometime.
Okay.
But we'll have character sheets that you can actually see and play with, and it won't be as complicated.
Oh, are we going to have interactable maps next time too? Are we going to be able to see our vision and or where we're at in placement for battle?
It depends on how far you get. I'll try to have a force scene if ready if you guys run into another encounter, but we'll see what happens.
Okay.
And now, out of curiosity, you said we could pick them up from somewhere. Where exactly is that somewhere, and what is it?
Oh yeah, give a little shout out to Darby's Dungeon. My friend Darby runs a tabletop board shop where she sells all sorts of board games and tabletop accessories and supplies.
This is where I got this beautiful book right here from.
Yeah. Yeah, shameless plug. But yeah, if you guys need any stuff for D&D, she's got D&D. She actually just picked up Alien RPG, which I guess there's an Alien RPG that is now a thing.
Ooh.
I've heard good things, but I haven't played it myself. But yeah. If you need any board games during this time of quarantine, hit her up. She's got a stock on Facebook, Darby's Dungeon. Let her know I sent you.
That is a good plug. Good idea.
Right?
So now we're just kind of hanging out and waiting until Servo goes live so we can go show him some love, go send everybody over there. So I guess, chat, any feedback from you guys? Any questions? Do you want a Q&A? Do you just want some A's? I don't know what you want here.
Anything you'd like to see? Yeah, we're gonna maybe start doing some special giveaways where we give away sticks.
Yeah, so I will give out personally signed sticks from Biff.
Oh, yeah.
Needed.
Give away Biff sticks. Biff sticks!
You want your own Biff stick? Huh? It'll have that authentic crick smell.
God. I'm so excited for that.
I'm doing the best I can. I'm like, what would Biff do in this situation? What would be the most out there southern ridiculousness that I could just bring to this?
I signed a stick.
God. Also,
it had to say "Made in the Creek" on the side of it.
Yeah. You get little stickers made that's just like "Made in the Creek."
Just little little fine print, like etch it in there with a crudely like etched in knife that says "Made in Creek."
I'm gonna have you cut a full length album in character, straight out of Crichton.
Nice.
Also, any suggestions from the chat while we have you guys here for community nights? What do you guys want to see? What kind of games do you want us to play? Do you want to play games with us? Do you want us to play something? Do you have suggestions? We can't play Crix. We can play in Crix, but we can't play Crix. Could I have a stick signed by the whole Remnant Gamers? We can get a whole lot of sticks. We'll get a bundle and we'll just sign them all and send them to you. Chibi is the bestest, weebiest Remnant. Minecraft? You want Minecraft, Mr. Question? We can do that. Servo and I both have a server together. A couple, actually.
Start punching trees, baby.
That's right, I'll get some sticks. Yep, I just heard the storm.
That's a good one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we also have a community channel in the Discord, so you guys can feel free to drop suggestions and things into there, too. So, definitely, if you're not already in the Discord, join that. Servo is now live, so we're going to go ahead and jump over to him, who is playing Minecraft, coincidentally. So thank you everybody for hanging out. Let's go show some love to him. Make sure that you spam in chat Hail Spray Tan. Or
Hail Spray Tan.
Or Sticks from the Crick. Your choice.
Sticks from the Crick.
Sticks from the Crick. And don't forget to catch us back here. What time are you streaming tomorrow night, Moose?
That'll be tomorrow night at 8 p.m.
8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time over here. On the Remnant channel for Moose Has an Aneurysm, the game. And of course, podcast on Sunday. Don't forget to follow us on social media. All of our audio is throughout every different platform you can find. Spotify, Stitcher, iTunes, anywhere that you find podcasts, guaranteed to find Remnant Gamers on. And another quick shout out to Darby's Dungeon for being fantastic and supplying us with everything we need for tonight. Thank you all for hanging out, and we will see you next time. Bye.
See you guys.
Peace out, Cub Scouts.